Like the United States and the rest of the NATO countries, the United Kingdom is not sending troops to fight in Ukraine. Prime Minister Boris Johnson confirmed that stance during a press conference today. But Johnson has called for Western nations to continue to supply weapons to Ukraine. For more on the Russian attack and the global response, Amna Nawaz, who's on Capitol Hill, speaks to the UK's ambassador to the United States.
That's right, Judy. For more on that international response and the effort to deter Russia, I'm joined by Dame Karen Pierce. She is the United Kingdom's ambassador to the United States. Ambassador Pierce, welcome back to the NewsHour. Thank you for joining us. I'd like to begin by asking for your assessment for the latest on the ground. You heard my colleague Nick Schifrin reporting there. It seems that Russian advance has stalled, but we've seen those satellite images, that column of tanks and Russian troops approaching Kyiv. Based on what you've heard, how concerned are you about a major Russian assault ahead?
I think it's true that the Russians are finding it much harder going than they had ever expected or planned for. That's partly because of the fantastic heroic resistance that your correspondents are seeing and showing to us. And it's very moving and it's very inspiring. But I think we do also have to remember the might of the Russian army and the fact that they continue to move on Kharkiv and on Kyiv. And I think that in the coming days, we will probably see an intensification of the fighting from the Russians. And that's obviously very concerning. It's a harder task than they thought, and there are reasons to be encouraged by that. But I think in the end, the overwhelming military might of the Russian forces will sadly lead to a bad result.
So let me ask you about the United Kingdom's support so far, because so far you've backed Ukraine with humanitarian aid and economic support, but also with defensive weapons. And just yesterday, Prime Minister Boris Johnson said to President Zelensky that the UK will provide more military support in the coming days. So what will that look like and when will it go?
That's right. We've already sent supplies, particularly anti-tank weapons, but I want to stress that these are defensive weapons, so the Ukrainian military can defend their country against the Russian aggression. We are supplying non-lethal equipment like body armor and a few more things that armies regularly need. We're looking at other equipment, defensive equipment, that we might be able to provide. British troops are there on the borders, in the NATO country, but helping to get military supplies into the Ukrainian military now.
Can I ask on the provision of even those defensive weapons, though? We've heard from some experts some concerns that even as those are being moved or stored in neighboring countries, how worried are you about Russian interdiction, about them possibly striking some of those weapons or storage facilities and taking this battle outside of the Ukrainian borders?
Nothing the Russians might do would sadly surprise me at this stage, to be absolutely honest. But we are doing our best to get the supplies into Ukraine through safe channels, through areas where we don't believe the Russians are operating. I won't say exactly where those are for fear of precipitating a bad result. But we are trying our best to help with the forward movement of all these supplies. We've sent 2,000 weapons from Britain. NATO allies are also sending supplies. And as I say, we're doing our best to get them through to where they're needed.
Madam Ambassador, I'd like to ask you about the sanctions, and particularly back in the United Kingdom. Your foreign secretary has said that you will be targeting oligarchs' properties and possessions. We know that many rich Russians have been buying up real estate, sending their children to British schools for years. Does that mean that you'll be seizing some of those assets in the coming days?
We have something called unexplained wealth orders, which enable us to seize illicit assets, and so those will be in force. We're revoking our visa investor scheme, so that will also have an effect. We have sanctioned individual oligarchs and those close to Putin, and we will be introducing an economic crime bill that will give us more powers to go after these illicit assets.
Finally, I'll ask you, you've mentioned that you hope that the oligarchs around Putin are talking to him and pressuring him. Do you believe that Putin is listening to those around him at this moment? Is he isolated or getting reliable information?
I think that's a really good question. I don't think we know for sure. We know that some of Putin's inner circle have been personally discomforted, if not worse, by what's happening on the sanctions. Does President Putin listen to advice? I don't know who in the Russian system can speak frankly to him and give him a very honest and frank assessment of the difficulties the Russians are encountering in their aggression towards Ukraine and what is going wrong with their plan. But I do hope he's getting those briefings because he needs to recalculate. He needs to stop the tanks that are there. And as Boris Johnson said in Poland, he needs to turn the tanks around and he needs to choose a path of peace.
That is Dame Karen Pierce, the United Kingdom's ambassador to the United States, joining us tonight. Madam Ambassador, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.